these days there's no shortage of Nissan GTRs pushing 2,000, even 3,000 horsepower. But of course, all of that power is useless if you can't get it to the track. And this is where managing the power delivery or the torque delivery is so critical. So we're here with Tony Palo from T1 Race to talk about how that's managed in the MoTeC M150 ECU. So Tony, the more typical way of managing torque in a turbocharged car is really by adjusting the boost targets, and often this is done as the car goes down the track. With the M150 package, it's quite different in the way the ECU actually works, in that it's what's referred to as a torque-based ECU. So can you tell us what the differences are between a torque-based system and a conventional ECU?
Yeah, so almost any new car on the road now is a torque-based system. It offers a lot of advantages. Whatever the reason is that you're limiting power or torque, it all boils down to torque, whether it's the engine or transmission failing or traction. It all comes down to torque. And so if we can maintain torque flat to redline, we can have a lot more horsepower than a typical torque curve that just peaks and falls. So the M150 for the GTR incorporates a full torque-based strategy that works really well. So it'll control throttle and or boost to meet your torque limit. It's that torque limit based on gear, speed, driver switch, whatever you want.
Now, one of the reasons that is critical, even in a relatively modest powered GTR, is because the torque needs to be modulated for the transmission to shift. Is that correct?
So there's different things. So we control torque under power, typically just for traction. Or if it's we're knock limited, maybe we're on 93 octane and the turbo can make a lot more. But then there's also the torque reduction strategy that has to happen on the shifts. So the way it works on these is the TCM sends a request for a torque reduction, and we have the option to fully listen to that request and obey that request, or at higher torque levels when we're making more torque than the TCM is kind of programmed for, then we take over to a full M1 strategy on that. So we'll use the TCM request in full at lower torque, so drivability is just like stock. And then at higher power, we have a threshold above, 500, 800 foot-pounds of torque. We go to a full M1-based strategy that is initiated by the TCM requesting, and then it's all on board in the M1.
Now, in terms of the tuners aspect, this sounds like it could be quite complex, tuning all of the associated data or tables related to that. So does that make it any more difficult, or is this all handled automatically in the background by the MoTeC?
It gives you more control.
Sorry, I'm talking about more in terms of just tuning the actual engine, so fuel and ignition strategy. So when you're actually on the dyno, do you need to tune a torque table to tell the ECU for a given throttle position or boost pressure versus RPM how much torque the engine is actually producing, or is the ECU calculating or modeling that in the background?
It's calculating and modeling all that. So it's primarily looking at your engine displacement and your volumetric efficiency. It assumes you're at MBT. So if you've got 10 degrees of timing out of it and it's making a lot more torque than it thinks you're making, there are compensation tables that you can go in if you find that the dyno doesn't agree with this, maybe the V table's off a little bit, whatever it is, you can make it as right as you want. For most cars, as long as you're keeping torque reasonably flat, everything's going to work well. It's not super critical that it's accurate to 50 foot-pounds. Because, we're not doing this going, oh, I know I can't go past this number. So if it's working well and it's within 30 or 50 pounds, it's going to work the same as if it wasn't.
I'll just elaborate on what you talked about there for those that maybe that's new to. So MBT timing, so that's where we're making maximum torque. So the ECU, in this case the M1's, just assuming that we're always at MBT timing, and a lot of OE applications that use torque modeling, they'll actually have a modification to the torque that's calculated based on how far away from MBT timing we are. So in this case, that's not happening in the M1, as you say, not really essential for the way you use it. So once it's actually tuned, once you've got the car off the dyno, let's talk about some of those advantages with the torque-based ECU. So how are you then manipulating the torque output as the car goes down the track? What access have you got? What control have you got over that?
I typically do torque by gear, because the reality is the second that gear changes, you've changed the torque to the tire and you can have more boost. And gear recognition is something that happens instantly on these. So as soon as it changes gear, it shoots up to the new torque limit, assuming you were reducing torque for traction. It'll control boost. When you're going down the track, it's always going to be boost control. You're at high enough boost. I set them up, you know, launch control and traction control are always active. If I'm not at full torque and it's not spinning, then it needs more, right? So I want it to be touching traction control here and there in every gear.
When you're just coming into that traction control just very slightly, it means you're right on that limit of the available traction.
Sure. If you're not spinning and you're not at full power, the car can go faster.
Now, in a lower sort of power application as well, you've mentioned the fact you've got the ability to use boost and or throttle control. So obviously, if you're at a position where you're already below the minimum wastegate spring pressure, we can't use boost control to drop the boost any further. So this is where the throttle control, I should say, strategy comes in. So can you talk to us about how that works?
So you're going to be 100% on the pedal, and the ECU you'll have your torque limit. And as torque approaches that, it'll just roll back the throttle to maintain torque there. And, you know, this car, for example, makes 1,500 horsepower. I can run it at 700 foot-pounds of torque, and it'll be at 15% throttle position at higher RPM, but it'll hold it nice and steady.
Look, it's really impressive, the advances we've seen in these aftermarket ECUs, and obviously this is why we're starting to see these cars go faster and faster. So thanks for the time to give us some insight into how that all works, and we'll let you get back to tuning. Thanks, Tony.
Cool, thanks.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions, which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.